Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents How Clients Buy, a practical guide to business development for consulting and professional services by Tom McMakin and Doug Fletcher, narrated by Barry Abrams. The Problem. Chapter 1. A Curious Problem. Was that you we saw last Friday night at the Seattle airport? We would have said hi, but you were on the phone. We were the guys in blue blazers dragging our rollerboards over to Evar's for a plate of oysters and a pyramid IPA. You might have seen us pounding out thank you notes on our phones before the late flight home. Allow us to introduce ourselves. Doug leads a business development consulting firm and sits on the board of a mid-sized consulting firm. Before that, he co-founded a technology-enabled consulting firm that specialized in global web survey projects. He got his start as a management consultant at A.T. Kearney, and before that, was trained on GE's leadership development program. Tom also runs a consulting firm that helps the biggest names in professional services grow their businesses, a kind of consultant to consultants. He was in private equity before that, and in his first big gig, served as the chief operating officer of Great Harvest Bread Company. This is all to say we've spent two lifetimes offering clients consulting and professional services. We've scoped projects, delivered outcomes, wined and dined clients, written white papers, presented at conferences, and relentlessly followed up. The proof? When people ask our kids what we do, the kids don't know. They travel a lot, they say. We've written this book to describe how clients buy consulting and professional services because we think if more people in our industry could get smarter about how expertise meets the opportunity to help, the world would be a better place. We look around and see lots of thorny problems that need solving. We also see lots of smart people ready to help. The challenge facing them both is to connect with each other more efficiently. Maybe you're an accountant, a lawyer, or an internet security specialist. Maybe you consult on strategy, human resources, finance, marketing, operations, or procurement. Or you're a freelance designer or marketing expert. You might be part of a large organization working for the big consultant Bain, the consulting and accounting firm KPMG, or the human resources specialist Aon. You might work out of a handsome glass and steel tower in downtown Boston or Chicago. Or you might be just starting out or recently retired, offering procurement, organizational or training advice, working out of your newly converted guest bedroom. Either way, this book is for you. Rainmaking. As a consultant or a person working in professional services, all of us know we have to become rainmakers, the people at the top who bring client business into their firms. In most large firms, you have to be successful bringing in new business to be considered for promotion to partner. And if you're a founder or co-founder in a small to mid-size firm, you live and die by the work you bring in to feed your troops. It's the harsh imperative of consulting and professional services. Being smart about something is not enough. You have to know how to engage with potential clients, understand their unique challenges, and scope business. You have to figure out a way to build a bridge from your expertise to those it can most help. You have to make it rain, or you will die in the desert of commerce. The problem is that selling consulting and professional services is hard. Some would say really, really hard. It's hard because selling consulting and professional services is different from selling shoes. The former is sold on relationships, referrals, and reputation, while the latter is sold on attributes like size, weight, color, style, and performance. It's the difference between an intangible and tangible sale. Further, despite the importance of becoming an effective rainmaker, we're never taught how to sell the work we do. We're trained as lawyers, accountants, web developers, financial analysts, engineers, or architects. How to do the work, but not in how to bring in new clients. Then there's the inconvenient fact that in our line of work, sales is a dirty word. While researching for this book, we interviewed dozens of rainmaking pros and were struck by how many of them said, "Never say sell." In fact, they reported that they don't even think about selling. To them, it's counterproductive. Dominic Barton, global managing partner of McKinsey & Company, one of the world's premier strategy consulting firms, put it this way: "If I mentioned sales in our firm, I'd be hauled up in front of our professional ethics board. It's just not the way we think." On top of that, our consulting niches are becoming more specific as they become more global. A client today is just as likely to be in Singapore as San Francisco. A generation or two ago, golf on Saturday was a good way to meet new clients. In the 21st century, methods like these are outdated. Finally, much of what we think we know about selling, the need to generate leads, pre-qualify them, then pitch and close prospects, is wholly inappropriate to consulting and professional services. What really matters is your relationship with a would-be client, which is formed and nurtured over a lifetime. Call it the rainmaker conundrum. We need to do business development or we die, and yet we're hobbled by obstacles that keep us from effectively developing this very same business. There must be a better way. Chuck McDonald, a senior attorney practicing in Columbia, South Carolina, puts it this way: "The one thing they don't teach you in law school is that the most important thing in private practice is how to get clients. You find out fairly early whether you are going to be able to do that, which enables you to climb the ladder within a firm structure. If you're not, you're not a fungible good. There are what we call worker bees, but they just don't get the same, frankly, respect within the firm or the same compensation. So it is a very important component." And so, it's strange to us that more isn't written about business development in the consulting and professional services trades. A quick Amazon search of books on the topic of leadership generates a staggering 191,348 listings. Yet you can count on one hand the number of books that have been written on becoming an effective rainmaker in the expert services professions. Consulting and professional services is a $1.7 trillion global industry, with 6.1 million of us in the United States working as consultants or in professional services. As the U.S. economy has shifted from manufacturing to a more knowledge-intensive economy, the consulting and professional services sector has expanded, enjoying growth that outpaces the wider economy. While gross domestic product grew on average 2.2% over the last 2 years, the consulting and professional services sector grew on average an astonishing 11.5%. That's five times as fast. It is high time we got smart about how to connect with those we can best serve. The promise of how clients buy. We will help you understand how clients buy consulting and professional services. This knowledge will increase the number of clients you have and earn you more money. More importantly, it will cause your expertise to find its home, solve more problems, and make the world a better place. To be clear, this is not a book on the sales funnel, selling techniques, better prospecting, persuasion, closing, or negotiation tactics. Instead, we describe the client's buying decision journey, knowing that it is this perspective that can give rise to a business development approach based on service and not manipulation. 10 qualities you do not need to benefit from this book. A certain size. You can work for a 400,000-person global IT services firm or have recently spun out on your own into a sole proprietorship. The principles of empathy for the customer, which are the foundation upon which increased engagement is built, are the same regardless of scale. A particular kind of expertise. You grow an HR consulting practice the same way you grow security consulting. Business development for law looks strikingly similar to business development for a strategy consultancy. A sales personality. It's a myth that only outgoing personalities succeed at building the kind of relationships that produce more engagements. In fact, many of the pros we interviewed reported the opposite. A big budget. When clients buy services, they do so in similar ways. Those patterns are largely uninfluenced by the size of your business development budget. That's because cash buys you reach, and yet services are sold on relationships, which are created one person at a time. While there are useful ways to spend money if you have it, supporting clients as they move through their decision-making journey does not require a lot of cash. A growing industry. High-growth sectors have challenges where outside expertise is required, but so do more stable industries. Ask any bankruptcy attorney or restructuring consultant if work is slow, and they will disabuse you of the idea that only growing companies hire consultants. A hot product set. If you bring a product sales sensibility to services sales, you will be tempted by the idea that new is better, that it is easier to sell the latest generation of phone than one built a decade ago. However, buyers of consulting and professional services are skeptical when expertise is packaged as a new offering. For them, a trusted advisor who solves problems alongside them is more important than something new. Level of experience. The fundamental business development challenges that face young professionals hoping to show off their commercial chops and make partner, and those confronting an old hand seeking to broaden their influence, are the same. A willingness to live on the road. Visiting would-be clients is a tried-and-true approach to business development, but there is a raft of technology-based and phone-based approaches that are equally effective at engaging and establishing relationships with potential clients. Marketing expertise. You're a designer or an accountant, a technologist or an engineer. You didn't spend a ton of your time in school taking marketing courses. No worries. Most marketing focuses on how to sell products, and as we will learn, clients buy services differently. The breakthrough. For us, the breakthrough in understanding how to best sell professional services was when we realized that those who successfully build their consulting and professional services practices are students of how clients buy and work to support that buying journey using very specific strategies and techniques. They aren't focused on sales at all. These pros tell us there are very specific requirements that must be satisfied before a client pulls a trigger and decides to buy our services. Preconditions we call the seven elements of how clients buy. Prospective clients become aware of your existence. This might be from an introduction from a friend, an article you wrote, or because they met you at a conference. They come to understand what you do and how you are unique. They can articulate what you do clearly to others. They develop an interest in you and your firm. They have goals set by themselves or others, and they can see how what you do might be useful in their efforts to realize those goals. What you do is relevant. They respect your work and are filled with confidence that you can help. They look to your track record, to their peers, and to a variety of social clues to determine if you are credible and likely to move the needle on their goals. They trust you, confident you will have their best interests at heart. They have the ability to pull the trigger, meaning they are in a position to corral the money and organizational support needed to buy from you. They are ready to do something. The timing is right inside their organizations, and they have the headspace to manage you. Our method. The advice that we offer in this book around each of these elements comes from three primary sources. 1. Interviews conducted with over 24 senior professionals working in a wide range of consulting and professional services, including law, accounting, investment banking, commercial real estate, and management consulting, strategy, advertising, and HR. While most of those we interviewed were seasoned rainmakers in their field, we did speak with a handful of individuals at the beginning and midway points of their careers. We spoke with individuals at some of the largest firms in their industry, and also with professionals at mid-sized boutique and solo firms. Finally, we spoke with professionals who bought professional services. 2. A review of the existing literature, both academic and popular, on the subject of business development for consulting and professional services. There are some strong materials out there. 3 of our favorites are Ford Harding's Rainmaking, Arthur Gensler's Arts Principles, and Mike Schultz and John Doerr's Professional Services Marketing. Our hope is that what we have written here builds on their work and contributes to the ongoing conversation about what works and what doesn't. Attention scholars, this book is not intended to be an academic publication. It's a book for and by practitioners. The breadth and depth of our research is not statistically weighty enough to be included in a peer-reviewed academic journal, nor are either of us PhD scientists, economists, or psychologists. That said, to the world of academia, we would say, jump in, the water's warm. The subject of how those with expertise engage with those they can most help in a highly distributed global world is ripe for further study. 3. Our collective experience working in management consulting and business services for 50 years. We looked to our own personal experiences in our consulting practices to capture what we had learned and share it. It was encouraging to us that much of what we feel is true was echoed in what we heard from those we interviewed. Onward! Your expertise deserves to find an audience, the exact right audience where what you know and what you've seen, and you've seen some stuff, will find a home where it can create value, not just for you, but more importantly, for the people whom you most want to serve. The world needs your expertise. Let's dig in and learn how to build a better bridge to those that could use it. Chapter 2. Finders, Minders, and Grinders. The Business Development Imperative. When Russell Davis first heard the news, he flew home from Switzerland early. Word had come to him from all directions, the foreign edition of CNN, urgent phone calls from home, and emotional email bursts from friends on campus. In a convulsion of violence, a mentally disturbed student shot and killed 32 students in the Norris and West Ambler Johnston halls at Virginia Tech. It was mid-April of 2007, and Russell was studying abroad, but he was also class president and a dyed-in-the-wool Hokie. I felt I needed to go home and be with everyone. The next few weeks were filled with emotions for Russell and for his fellow students, a complicated stew of anger at the shooter, grief over the lost promise of those who had been slain, and relief and guilt over having not been a target. Russell remembers trying to frame the right words for his address to the graduating class in May. I wanted to be careful. It was a commencement, not a funeral, he said. In the end, standing in front of 5,000 graduates at Worsham Field, he spoke from the heart. You only live once. Never waste a moment. Russell showed leadership in the way he chose to be with those whom he had decided to serve. It wasn't like Mel Gibson on a stallion, rallying of the Scottish tribes in Braveheart, but a quieter call to duty, which becomes the standard against which the rest of us measure ourselves. At Virginia's Darden School of Business, where Russell earned an MBA after Virginia Tech, roughly half of the students apply for jobs at the big consulting firms. Of those, half get interviews, and then half of them get offers. It is the same at all the leading business schools. Boston Consulting Group, BCG, one of the country's premier strategy consulting firms, has a mission to go deep to unlock insight and have the courage to act. For that, They need leaders and strong thinkers who have the courage of their convictions. When they first met Russell on the campus of the University of Virginia, they must have known they'd found a real leader, recruiting him to be a summer intern in between years at business school. Later, when he graduated, BCG asked him to sign on full-time as a consultant. Getting hired by one of the big consulting firms is, for many, like winning the lottery. BCG and the others would come in and make presentations to the students and talk about the cool strategy work they did for clients. I know I would learn a lot in consulting and that it would open doors. Those of us who got offers were pretty excited. BCG, McKinsey, and Bain have a line out the door to get in. They get the best and brightest. Consulting. Consulting draws some of the best business school students because consultants are called in to do challenging and essential work. Since working at BCG, reports Russell, I've worked on growth strategy, cost reduction, and operations projects in consumer products, transportation, and industrial goods. I've learned a lot in 2 years. I travel a fair bit, but the firm treats me well and I make good money. Really good money. The average starting salary for a post-MBA graduate like Russell at BCG is $147,000, with another $50,000 to $70,000 piled on top in bonuses and 401k contributions. This wage is not the exception but the rule at the most prestigious firms like Bain, McKinsey, Oliver Wyman, LEK, and A.T. Kearney. It's the same with the big four professional services firms, where KPMG, Deloitte, EY, and PwC all pay total compensation north of $150,000 for recent MBA graduates, as do the big IT consulting firms like Accenture and IBM. I'm not even in that universe. If you are a sole proprietor, work for a small CPA firm, or have just hung up your shingle as an attorney, Russell's world may seem distant and vaguely exotic, like GNZ 11, the galaxy Hubble just discovered at the far reaches of space. Interesting, but not really relevant. You hear about hundreds of thousands of dollars in pay, and you think to yourself, hundreds of thousands of dollars of revenue would be good. We understand. Both of us have been sole proprietors. Tom remembers launching a private equity firm and wondering if the deals would come in. I'd lie awake at night thinking about the kids and the next mortgage payment and see blood dripping from the ceiling. Doug remembers flying out to New York to make a big client pitch and wondering if he had made some sort of tragic mistake leaving the security of a job at General Electric to launch his fledgling consultancy. Stick with us. We're digging into the world of high-end consultants for a reason. It turns out their problems are the same as ours, and in their experience, there are clues as to how clients buy. The ladder. Russell learned a few things about consulting while working at BCG. There's a distinct ladder. As a new consultant, there's an expectation that you get up to speed quickly and that you contribute quickly. If you join BCG right out of undergrad, they call you an associate. If you get promoted from that or join post-MBA, you're a consultant. After consultant, you become a project leader, where you manage a team and probably have a couple of consultants and maybe an associate working with you. 2 years after being a project leader, you might get promoted to principal and have two project leaders working under you. If you work as a principal for between 3 and 5 years, you'd be eligible to stand for election to the partnership. Then, as a partner, you might be promoted to senior partner and possibly to the firm's leadership. While the titles might be different if you are in an architectural or law firm, the idea is the same. First, you toil with the rest of the recent grads, and if you are good, you advance one rung on the ladder at a time, and the firm makes it worth your time. Partners at BCG make 7 figures with bonuses and profit sharing. If you're a kid from Staunton, Virginia like Russell, that has your full attention and absolute dedication. up, or out. The second lesson Russell learned at BCG was harsher. It's up or out here. The messaging starts as soon as you get here. Look around you, they say. There are not as many partners as there are consultants. Do the math. Not everyone can be partner. Everyone talks about it, he says. You know you'll either get promoted or you'll get the boot, though no one ever really gets fired. Instead, you hear someone left the firm to take on an opportunity in industry. What you don't hear is that it wasn't 100% their choice. And it happens on every step on the ladder. There is constant pruning. Everyone who enters into BCG is taught this basic lesson and so begins to ask the natural question, what do I need to do to succeed here? It is a Darwinian meritocracy in which only the best survive. Everyone else is counseled out. It's all very polite, but large consulting firms are built to be unforgiving pyramids in which not everyone can succeed. The Kravath System. Paul Kravath was born in Ohio in the summer of 1861. A graduate of the Oberlin College and Columbia Law, he would tell fellow New York attorneys that Kravath was derived from the Czech word for tailor, which itself came from the word for cut. It would always get a chuckle because his friends knew him to be a fan of managing his law firm by cutting underperforming professionals. Kravath towered over his colleagues at 6'4". A name partner in the firm now known as Kravath, Swain, and Moore, he served clients like Chemical Bank, Bethlehem Steel, and the Studebaker Corporation, and was known as one of the most respected attorneys in the country. He had very clear ideas about how a law firm should be run, ideas which were not commonplace. His approach became known as the Kravath System. Hire the best attorneys from the best law schools. Look to grades as a way of predicting success in the law. Pay them well. Up until Kravath, young attorneys apprenticed themselves, trading their time for training. To pay young attorneys was revolutionary. Train them extensively by rotating them between assignments. Kravath did not believe in silos. He thought broadly experienced attorneys brought the most value to clients. Reward merit. Kravath believed in running his firm as a meritocracy. Young attorneys were promoted for being successful, or, if they did not make the cut, they were dismissed. Today, nearly all consulting and professional services firms are managed this way. Kravath's system has become ubiquitous for three important reasons. Leverage. Partners can get paid more if they do not just bill out at their hourly rate, but also take a slice of what their junior associates bill out for. If you just bill out at your rate, there is a cap on what you can make. But if you act like a value-added reseller of other people's time, there's no limit to what you can make. Your pay is only a function of the size of the assignments you find and the number of people required to do the work. It's the business model. Motivation. Young associates will work longer hours, grinding away with enthusiasm, if they feel one day their reward might be millions of dollars and a membership at the Greenwich Country Club. Also, they know if they don't, they'll be fired. Call it the carrot and cudgel approach. Quality. It's hard to hire well. Using top law schools as an initial screen on who is good and who is not saves time. The three-legged stool. Over beers on the weekend, Russell and his newly minted colleagues would talk about what it takes to get ahead at BCG. The first leg, and everyone agrees on this point, is you must be good at the work. This goes for every kind of professional service, law or IT consulting, as well as the more rarefied world of strategy consulting. No one gets from the first to the second rung without doing a good job at delivering the service that is embedded in the promise of their firm. Accenture is the largest IT consultant in the world. If Accenture says it will produce actionable data from multiple sources in and outside of a business, you must be able to do that for clients, or Accenture and you will get fired. The second leg is team leadership. You must be able to rodeo others on a team who are delivering the work. If a Seattle-based CPA firm sends a group of professionals to audit the books at a cannery in Alaska, they'll send a team leader to keep everyone driving in the same direction. She'll also get to pick where everyone has drinks after work. Both of these skills, doing the work and leading others in the delivery of work, have beginning, intermediate, advanced, and master versions. Fixing the e-commerce site of a $30 million retailer of sporting goods is hard. Our friends at Accenture tell us that fixing healthcare.gov was harder. The first job was a blue square groomer. The second, a black diamond pitch off the backside. The third leg of the stool is the ability to generate new business. It's one thing to be able to do the work well and to lead successful engagement, but someone in the firm has to be the one who spoke with the client in the first place, inking the deal that got the work. Art Gensler, author of Art's Principles and founder of Gensler, the premier design and architecture firm that designed the Apple Store, says, "Business rarely falls into your lap. You must go out, explore, and find clients." The commercial imperative. They say in consulting and professional services that there are finders, minders, and grinders. Grinders do the work. Minders supervise the grinders. Finders bring in the work on which everyone else delivers. Russell is clear on this rainmaker imperative. By the time you are a partner, you need to have a commercial focus. You need to come across as credible and be able to sell a multi-million dollar transformation to a company. But to know what to do is not to know how to do it. If I had one question for a senior partner at the firm, says Russell, it would be, how did they find their best clients? Most of the work at a big firm like BCG comes from repeat business and from referrals. But I would be interested in knowing what the partner did, especially in the early years, to find those big clients that hire us over and over. We find this question interesting as well. The rest of us. This question of how to find new work is not limited to the big firms. It's common to all consultants or professional service providers. While website designers or freelance cybersecurity specialists might not be working in the Kravath salt mines at a 10,000-person professional services firm, they experience their own version of up or out. They either bring in new work or they fail. "If I don't sell, I am out of business," says Megan Armstrong, the owner of a 3-person marketing communications company. "Without clients, there's no work." It's really just a variation on the same theme. To be successful in consulting and professional services, you have to be a grinder, a minder, and a finder. It is the platform on which all of us stand. If you're weak at any one of these three disciplines, the stool will not support your weight. If you're at a big firm, it means you'll wash out and not make partner. If you're a sole proprietor, your enterprise will fail. Okay, I need to sell. How do I do that? Saying that those in consulting and professional services need to think about where their next meal is coming from is not a controversial statement. How to do that, as we will see, is controversial. Some see expert services as just another product that can be sold, like a pen or a load of lumber. Others, and we are in this camp, see consulting and professional services as very different, requiring a unique approach. Russell knows that he has to learn how to go out and find business if he is going to make it in this world of consulting. He also knows it's going to be hard. It's a skill he didn't learn in business school. So we took his question to the best in this business, We interviewed some of the most accomplished pros and learned why selling consulting and professional services is a challenge. In the next chapter, we will work to better understand how consulting and professional service practitioners engage with would-be clients is different from the way other goods are sold. The goal is not to sell what we do, but to be invited by clients into their projects as trusted partners. Obstacles. Chapter 3. Beyond Pixels. Selling a service is different from selling things, and harder too. Selling high-end expert services is different from selling ice creams or iPads. Economists call consulting and professional services credence goods. Asher Walensky, a microeconomics professor at Northwestern University, puts it this way. The term credence good refers to goods and services whose sellers are also experts who determine the customer's needs. This feature is shared by medical and legal services and a wide variety of business services. In such markets, even when the success of performing the service is observable, customers often cannot determine the extent of the service that was needed and how much was actually performed. We all know the feeling. You drop off your laptop at the repair shop in the mall because you woke up on Monday morning to the blue screen of death. There is a nice guy there whose job it is to wrangle customers. He tells you he will call you later once they look under the hood. You suspect he was hired because he is a smooth talker and not because he really knows anything about computers. It feels like his job is to keep you away from the tech guys. He calls you mid-morning. We took a look at your laptop. Your memory board is most likely fried. We're going to run a diagnostic test, and that will help us better understand what is going on, but I wanted to warn you that it might require a new memory board. You search for the right way to respond. It's just over a year old. You are whispering into your cell because you are on site at a client. Why did this happen? It is actually fairly common with this computer. The company claims there are no manufacturing defects, but we see the same problem in here all the time. It was a bad batch of chips from a startup manufacturer in Taiwan. Depending on what we find, you might get away with just adding a memory board, or it could require a new motherboard, which is not going to be cheap. Next time, you may want to consider the extended warranty. Okay. You say weakly, give me a call when you are done with the diagnostic. Will do. You are in the hands of an expert and totally at their mercy. It's the same thing at the doctor. Let me consult with some of my colleagues and then we can talk about therapy options. It is a queasy, helpless feeling. They are the experts and they are both defining the problem and making a recommendation. Dr. Walensky calls this information asymmetry. One side knows everything, and the other side knows what they Googled on WebMD. This asymmetry is one of the reasons selling legal services is a lot like selling cybersecurity expertise, even though the lawyer's capabilities are very different from those of the security consultant. All expert service providers sell services under circumstances in which the client has to trust them implicitly. Think about when you speak with an attorney about using a boilerplate non-disclosure form you got off the internet. Businesses have been swapping NDAs for decades, you say. Surely they're all the same. Inevitably, though, your attorney uses their expertise to point out that the generic form you found on www.howhardcanlawbeafterall.com doesn't actually cover your specific business. Because your intellectual property resides in Ireland, we will need to include a section to make sure you are protected there. Also, we will need to change the arbitration.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.